Welcome back to the channel. Today we're going to be taking a look at my Hackintosh build that I put together to compile all the parts necessary that I needed for my new dedicated editing rig. So why did I do it? Well, here's the thing. Simply put, performance. In Geekbench testing, my new Hackintosh here in single core performance outperforms everything by up to 13%. And a multi-core score, it comes in just shy of the brand new iMac Pros that are $5,000. So you can see why it would be appealing to go to a Hackintosh and save thousands of dollars and outperform some of the top-end products that Apple is currently offering. But I just don't think the new processing power to dollar ratio that you're getting from the new Apple products is really worth it. So unfortunately, they twisted my arm and I decided to go down the route of a Hackintosh. If you don't know what a Hackintosh is, well, basically it is building your own PC and then loading it with the Apple software. So I've got my Hackintosh, a built powerful PC running Apple Mojave operating system, OS X 10.14,
I keep thinking I'm forgetting something.
So let's go ahead and jump into what exactly is in my Hackintosh build. So for a processor, I went with the Intel i7 core processor. I know i9 just came out not too long ago. I could have went that way, but like I said, everything was so new to me. I'm a complete noob when it comes to PC building. I just went with something I knew was going to be working well and that it was not going to be super outdated relatively soon. So i7 is what I went with. And then I went for two sticks of Corsair Vengeance LPX memory. And then for an SSD, I went with the Samsung 512GB 970 Pro. Didn't really want to go overboard with the SSD memory. I edit off of hard drives, so I'm not going to be utilizing a whole lot of SSD storage space. As far as my motherboard, I went with the Strix Z390E Gaming from Asus. So this thing has RGB lighting, but it's very minimal. I didn't want to go too crazy because I planned on adding some lights, so I didn't want it to go overwhelming, but I like this. It's got all the ports you could possibly want on this thing. It's got, you know, USB 3, USB-C, all sorts of connectivity, and it was really reasonably priced. And to cool that bad boy, I went with a Thermalake 3.0 water-cooled radiator. It's got two built-in fans, so it'll keep that board nice and cool. And then a little bit of overkill, I went with the EVGA Supernova 750P2 for my power supply. All the possible cords and cables you could ever possibly want to hook up to any kind of system. That thing was overkill, but again, I wanted to build certain things that would be a little bit future-proof, so if I have to build an add-on later on, I'll be using that one. And then lastly, I went with the Radeon RX 570 as far as my graphics card. There's newer, better things out there, but the reason I went with this, this has a lot of native support from Final Cut Pro, and it runs smoothly, and it's gonna really help my processing power when I'm doing those heavy 4K or, you know, 360 video edits in the future. For my case itself, I went with the Fantex Entho Pro. This is a solid, well-priced, well-built, in my opinion, mid-tower case. Comes with two fans included. There's lots of space in this for hiding your wires, plenty of room for breathability, keep this thing nice and cool, make sure you're not overheating. And to spruce it up a little bit, I went with two Asus RGB addressable LED strips, and I've got those decorated around the sides of the tower itself. And just to top things off, I threw in my best bud there, RYU, make sure he's watching over my computer, make sure everything is running up to snuff. It was a nice little finishing piece that I just decided I wanted to add to the case since I had that little extra bit of room on the side of the tower there. And for Wi-Fi, since Hackintosh builds can be a little finicky with motherboards and compatibility with Wi-Fi, I just played it safe and I went with an official Apple Wi-Fi controller board with Bluetooth. So now I've got full Wi-Fi capabilities, Bluetooth connectability, and all of this works without me having to install any new drivers or look up any fancy workarounds, anything like that. I just plugged it into my PCIe board, boom, Wi-Fi instantly. I love it, and I'm not ashamed that I paid an extra $60 to get an official Apple product because, quite frankly, it's worth the peace of mind. To round things off of my desktop, I went with the Razer Gaming Black Widow Elite keyboard. Again, a little bit of overkill. I liked it though because it's got the built-in controls for my volume settings, my, you know, my play, my pause, my forward, rewind. It's also got a USB pass-through, so I can use the side. I'm just gonna put my SD cards and my hard drives, that way I can connect them up real quick and dump the footage I'm recording from videos and then put those on a hard drive and get editing as quick as possible. And for my monitor, I went with a 43-inch Samsung 4K display. Yes, I know it's huge, but honestly, it isn't as bothersome or hindrance that I thought it was gonna be. I sit far enough away from it that I don't have to do some head scrolling when I'm editing or surfing the web or anything like that. So it works out smooth. I enjoy it a lot. And oddly enough, this thing was actually $150 cheaper than a 32-inch version that I was looking at. So one thing I'm very partial to is Samsung displays. I've always used Samsung displays for everything I've ever had in my houses. And I will probably never use anything but Samsung as long as they keep up their top-notch picture quality. I absolutely love the colors, I love the way the display looks, and I'm one of the few people that is actually quite fond of Auto Motion Plus, that thing that kind of makes Samsung displays look like soap operas. So I'm one of the few people that actually likes that, so that's another reason why I like Samsung displays. But again, got this bad boy for $275, which again, 43 inches, 4K, $275. Hard to say no to that, so that's why I went with a 43-inch display, but quite frankly, I don't regret it. Enjoy having that extra monitor space, and it's a beautiful display. HDR compatible, beautiful range of colors, and it is immaculate. And then other things around the desk, I decided I should go ahead and make this kind of my retro gaming station, as I've got all my other, you know, new age consoles hooked up to my projection screen in my media room. But I've got my Nintendo NES Classic, my Super NES Classic, and my PlayStation Classic all hooked up to where I can play all my retro favorite games. Obviously, I've went ahead and hacked all three of these systems. They're super fun to play now that you hack them and you can add whatever games you want. And then to surround them with some other cool things and just a little nerdy decor, I've got the Devoom TiVo. It's a little 8-bit speaker device. I use it for a Bluetooth speaker. I edit with Bluetooth headphones, but if I don't want to have the headphones on, I can route all my computer sound through that, and it is very loud. It's kind of impressive because it's about the size of a baseball, but it is extremely loud. It's got a built-in subwoofer. Amazing little device. You can change all the 8-bit things you want, add, build, create your own. And also I have the Devoom Time Box, which is very similar to the TiVo, but it's a little bit different because it has a built-in radio. It's also a built-in speaker, but it does the weather, connects to the app. Obviously you can change the settings and, you know, upload your own 8-bit art as well. But this is typically what I have it staying on. I've got that one used as a speaker. This one's just kind of for decoration. I'll have a bunch of 8-bit characters going through and cycling in the background once in a while. I do need a new desk. This is literally just a fold-up table, and I didn't go get a desk. So any suggestions for a desk, let me know. I just need something sturdy enough to hold everything, maybe a drawer or two, just so I can store some gear, and that's it. Thanks everybody for watching this video. If you're interested in building your own Hackintosh, I'll be sure to leave some of the resource links down below in the video description box below, as well as product links to all the things that I use to build my Hackintosh. If you're new to the channel, make sure you subscribe and hit that notification bell so you'll be the first to know every time I upload a new video. And as always, thanks for watching, guys.